Ashet Audio presents Good Boss, Bad Boss. How to be the best and learn from the worst. Written by Robert I. Sutton, PhD. Read by Bob Walter.
To Marina, for every sweet little thing. Preface. From Assholes to Bosses. My last book, The No Asshole Rule, is about the damage done by workplace jerks, what it takes to survive a nasty workplace, and how organizations can screen out, reform, and expel these demeaning and destructive creeps. I was overwhelmed by the sheer volume of reactions to the book, and more so by the pain, fear, and desperate cries for help, and success stories, too, that I heard and responded to day after day. As a colleague put it, "Bob, you have become the asshole guy. It's a job that takes a lot of time and emotional energy." I was inundated with asshole stories from all over the world. Thousands of personal stories, survival tips, and new studies poured in via email and comments on my blog, calls from complete strangers, and nearly every work-related conversation that I had, regardless of the advertised topic of a meeting, class, or speech. There was no escaping it outside of work either. People told me asshole stories every place I went: cocktail parties, family gatherings, soccer games, weddings, a bat mitzvah, a funeral, and even a parent-teacher conference. The deluge has slowed, but not stopped. Consider a recent week. I received and answered 19 asshole emails, including from a police sergeant in New York, a Starbucks barista in Chicago, an accountant from Italy, and an HR manager from Wisconsin who struggled to implement the no-asshole rule in a small company. Her old boss loved it, but her new boss is a screamer and thinks it's a dumb idea. I talked with a Hollywood insider about the asshole management methods used by people who work with Academy Award-winning producer Scott Rudin, who is infamous for his tirades, tantrums, and burning through as many as 50 assistants a year. One tip for dealing with Rudin was, he hates when you look at him. Avoid it, or you are asking for it. This advice was offered in concert with a possibly mythical but often repeated story that Rudin had dumped an assistant on the side of a Los Angeles freeway as punishment for glancing at him in the rearview mirror too many times. That same week, I spent most of a 90-minute interview with a Japanese journalist listening to bitter complaints about his temperamental, unfair, and incompetent boss back in Tokyo. This deluge revealed new twists about how assholes do their dirty work and how to battle back against these creeps. Adamant and enthusiastic readers bombarded me with topics they wanted covered in a sequel to the No Asshole Rule. An Australian consultant asked for tips about dealing with asshole clients. A New Jersey schoolteacher requested tactics for battling subtle or camouflaged assholes. A Catholic priest wanted tactics for dealing with difficult parishioners. During one of my speeches, a pushy audience member insisted that I drop my other projects and devote my life to leading an anti-asshole movement. People in the book business pressed for a sequel, too. My favorite inquiry came in a handwritten note from Marie-Pierre Vasselet, who edited the French translation of the no-asshole rule, Objectif Zéro Salcon. In her elegant cursive, Marie-Pierre seemed to be asking, "Bob, will I be seeing the asshole shits again soon?" These pressures and temptations provoked me to start working on a sequel. But a funny thing happened along the way. As I thought about all those stories and conversations and read pertinent research, I realized the asshole problem wasn't an isolated concern for most employees and in most workplaces. It was intertwined with feelings, opinions, and aspirations that swirled around a central figure, the boss. I realized that the best bosses did far more than enforce the no-asshole rule. They took diverse and intertwined steps to create effective and humane workplaces. And the worst bosses weren't just guilty of letting assholes rule the roost. Their incompetence reared its ugly head in a host of other ways. Bosses were the central figures in most stories I heard about the creeps who damaged employees' performance and self-worth. Consider the salesman whose email was titled, "Had Leukemia, Bullied by a Bad Manager." When chemotherapy began draining his energy, his wicked boss doubled his sales quota and called each day to berate him for being a wimp and a fuck-up. Or the legal secretary who was treated as if she were invisible by the attorneys she served. These pompous and self-absorbed jerks never greeted her when passing by, and often held long and loud conversations right in front of her desk without stopping for a moment to acknowledge her existence. Or the obstetrician who was belittled so brutally by senior physicians during her training that it undermined her confidence during difficult deliveries throughout her career. The prevalence of asshole bosses is confirmed by careful studies. A 2007 Zogby survey of nearly 8,000 American adults found that, of those abused by workplace bullies, 37% of respondents, 72% were bullied by superiors. Stories about the damage done by bully bosses are bolstered by systematic research. University of Florida researchers found that employees with abusive bosses were more likely than others to slow down or make errors on purpose, 30% versus 6%, hide from their bosses, 27% versus 4%, not put in maximum effort, 33% versus 9%, and take sick time when they weren't sick, 29% versus 4%. Abused employees were 3 times less likely to make suggestions or go out of their way to fix workplace problems. Abusive superiors also drive out employees. Over 20 million Americans have left jobs to flee from workplace bullies, most of whom were bosses. Yet, when people look for or dream of a great boss, they want more than someone who just isn't a certified asshole. They want a civilized boss who does many things well. Take the young professor who told me about her escape from a nasty and sexist department chairman. She landed a job with a new chair who was not just a delightful human being. He was renowned for getting resources for faculty and protecting them from petty and time-consuming political battles. The no-asshole rule touched a nerve in bosses and would-be bosses because treating people with dignity is something that skilled bosses do, but not the only thing. I think of the high school principal from Illinois who worked to get her teachers to stop trying to destroy each other because you will be better for it and so will our students. Changing the emotional tone of the place was part of a 5-point plan she was implementing to turn around a troubled school. I think of the chief surgeon who treats nurses and residents with respect because during his own surgical residency, he vowed not to become a demeaning and self-absorbed creep like the surgeons who trained him. He emphasized that respect was important for reducing medical mistakes because nurses and residents need to feel safe, even obligated to point out errors made by him and other senior physicians without fear of retribution. As another physician explained, just because you aren't an asshole doesn't mean that a nurse will feel comfortable pointing out that you screwed up. The best bosses don't see the no-asshole rule as an isolated path to excellence. They see it as part of a bigger toolkit. In short, workplace assholes led me to write Good Boss, Bad Boss because I was inundated with so many people who yearned to be skilled bosses and to work for one. I use the word boss rather than leader, manager, or supervisor, although all are bosses, because it implies an authority figure that has direct and frequent contact with subordinates.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.